Speaking now for the 37 nations with consular representatives in the city of Philadelphia, Mr. Thomas S. Tull, Her Britannic Majesty's consul to the city of Philadelphia.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, here at Independence Hall, 18 months ago, the man whom we honor today proclaimed the interdependence of all nations. It is perhaps therefore fitting that one person, however inadequately, should try to speak not only on behalf of his colleagues and himself and the countries which they represent, but also perhaps for all those countless millions of men and women across the seas who share this hour with you. For this is a universal tragedy. We all mourn with the American people. We share with them their shock and their grief. We join with them in their outpourings of sympathy and in their prayers for Mrs. Kennedy and for the President's family. We offer, too, our prayers and support for President Johnson in the tasks which lie ahead of him. We have all lost a loyal and faithful friend, a brave statesman killed in the full vigor of his manhood when he bore on his shoulders all the cares and hopes of all of us, one who strove always to make the world a better and a safer place for ordinary men and women to live in. We shall always remember John Fitzgerald Kennedy as a man of peace, a man of deep religious faith, which was dedicated to healing divisions between men, a courageous, just, and tolerant man. For us, as for the American people, his loss is a deep and sad one. We can only rededicate ourselves to those things which he liked, which he loved, and for which he worked during his life. And if we can help to bring to the world the tolerance, liberty, justice, and peace for which he did so much, then we shall be doing something to serve the causes in the service of which he himself died.
One of the frequently read volumes in Mr. Kennedy's library was the collected works of Robert Frost. The late president is said to have counted among his favorites the poem which will now be read by the distinguished actor, Jose Ferrer.
Escapist Never by Robert Frost. He is no fugitive, escaped, escaping. No one has seen him stumble, looking back. His fear is not behind him, but beside him on either hand, to make his course perhaps a crooked straightness, yet no less a straightness. He runs face forward. He is a pursuer. He seeks a seeker who in his turn seeks another still, lost far into the distance. Any who seek him, seek in him the seeker. His life is a pursuit of a pursuit forever. It is the future that creates his present. All is an interminable chain of longing.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Honorable William W. Scranton, Governor of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania.
Distinguished guests, reverend clergy, my fellow Pennsylvanians, my fellow Americans, we stand today in the comforting shadow of one of mankind's great shrines to the cause of human freedom. We are comforted because we know that cause is timeless. Yet we know, too, that we are a far different people than we would have been had we gathered here a week ago for some other purpose. We are not here to be mere verbal patriots. Today, a president lies dead, a martyr to that same great cause of human freedom. A first lady grieves with a courage all admire, and two small children will probably never realize how fully a great nation sorrows for them. This nation mourns because a dark shadow has crept across our national conscience. This generation of Americans has lost forever the easy privilege of deadening that conscience with a narcotic of complacency. With just cause, we have fancied ourselves a people in the forefront of the human experiment in freedom and government by law. So far removed are we in time from the sacrifice of our forefathers, that perhaps it is understandable we had come to view the government they founded with a certain complacency. Just 100 years ago, only shortly before he too died by violence, Abraham Lincoln wrote, "Among free men, there can be no successful appeal from the ballot to the bullet." And surely of all the world's chiefs of state, the American president should be most secure from murder by a constituent. He is elected by almost universal suffrage. His term is limited by law, and every citizen has the right to express disagreement with national policies. But yet the despicable has happened. Our national leader has been shot down in cold blood, and his body lies lifeless. Beyond our grief and our anger, what must this mean for all Americans? This terrible violence, done both to a fine man and to our system of government, cries out for a greater rededication by us all. It must make us realize that the American experiment is not yet complete. We still have much to do if freedom's cause is to be fully won. A new generation of Americans must stand for compassion, not hate, for tolerance, not prejudice. Today we are a nation united in sorrow and in prayer. Tomorrow we must be a nation united in a new dedication to the values of human freedom and self-government. Otherwise, two small children will have lost not only their father, but their birthright as well. No man would pray that we so unite more than the leader now gone, for he lived and died so dedicated. God bless him, and God help us.
The Honorable Richard J. Hughes, Governor of the State of New Jersey.
Distinguished guests, Governor Scranton, Mayor Tate, Reverend clergy, ladies and gentlemen, I feel that all of you are distinguished by the spirit of love which brought you here today to this hallowed place to think for a little while about the president who lies dead in Washington. I remember being here on that warm July 4th when this young, fearless American stood on this same platform in this same place and spoke words of hope and courage to all the world. And now John Kennedy belongs to history. This young and courageous spirit, so vibrant in life, stilled by a senseless and an evil act. But he would have lived in vain and died in vain if we do not now resolve, as has been said here today, as one people, all together, to follow his example of dedication and to make his ideals our ideals. His life was one of service to his own people and to the people of all the world to whom he was speaking on that July day here in Philadelphia. In the service of freedom some 20 years ago now, his body absorbed the wounds of battle, and the world first learned of his capacity for courage. And from the fire of war emerged a man of peace, and a man who was to become the leader of mankind's search for peace and justice. John Kennedy was a man of hope and determination, for he believed in man's ability, with God's help, to shape the course of human affairs. I recall that one time he said that the tide of history is not running against the United States, but will go in the direction in which strong and resolute men cause it to go. And he was just that kind of a man. In the months and years ahead of us, each one of us should assume, I think, as a personal duty, a dedication that America does continue in his determined spirit, the work of President Kennedy. His words and his acts point out the way very clearly to us, and I think we should, as we mourn for the man who said these great things that have been repeated here today, we should begin to appreciate the full meaning of those words, words like, ask what you can do for your country. Indeed, it has been possible to measure that meaning, the meaning of those words, in his many acts as president. For John Kennedy worked for peace and justice through strength and negotiation, and so must we. His was the way of reason and tolerance in meeting the challenges of our times. So must ours be. He sought to bring the full benefits of freedom and equal opportunity to all Americans. So must we do. His was a search for justice for the poor, for the retarded, for the underprivileged, for the handicapped, for all those in need of help of their fellow man. And so must our effort be. To John Kennedy, the ultimate strength of America was in her people, their unity, their bonds of brotherhood. We can recognize that strength in the unquestioned manner in which all Americans now have pledged their support for our new president, Lyndon B. Johnson, as he takes up the tasks and the awful responsibilities of the world's most powerful office. And it is a tribute to the American people which may diminish in some small way the shock and the shame we feel that one among us betrayed the spirit and meaning of this great nation by this mad act of assassination. So as we grieve, let us pledge as a firm, a real, a sacred obligation, our determination to act in a manner befitting the memory of John Fitzgerald Kennedy, a manner in which the good which is within all of us one day will triumph over the evil and the hate that last Friday cast its shadow over this nation. This will be our profile and courage. This will be our real tribute to the memory of a great American.
Ladies and gentlemen,